Now, let's go to the seer. On the sixth year of Hijrah, a major incident took place. What was it? When the Prophet intended to go and do Umrah, the Quraysh stopped him. They stopped him from doing his Umrah. And they stopped at a place called Al-Hudaybiyah. And they did Sulh Al-Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah. This was the sixth year. And they had some conditions for this treaty. The Prophet ﷺ went back to Medina. Okay? That year, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he decided to take Islam further out of the Arabian Peninsula. He started sending messengers to different countries, to different nations, to different emperors. He sent to the king of Kisra, to the emperor, to the Persian emperor, and to the emperor of the Romans, and to the king of Egypt, and to Najashi in East Africa, Abyssinia. At that time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, somehow the pagans broke the treaty of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet planned to go and invade Mecca. One of the Sahaba heard this news. When he heard this news, he could not help himself for some reason. What did he do? He wrote this news in a letter and he sent it to the Meccans, informing them and tipping them that Muhammad is about to invade you. Prepare yourself, prepare your army. Who is this Sahabi? This companion, radiallahu anhu arda, he was Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a. Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a, radiallahu anhu arda. He sent this message with a woman. Jibra'il came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and revealed to him that this is what happened. Send for that woman to be arrested before the Quraysh are tipped with this news. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Ali and another Sahabi to catch this woman before she delivers the message. They caught her there before she reached Mecca. They asked her to give them the letter. She refused. She said, I've got no letter. She denied that. Ali insisted. She insisted too. Ali said, look, I'm ready to do everything, even to remove your clothes to take the letter away from you. That's the order of our Rasul. It must be obeyed, not playing around. So he threatened her with that. When she heard that, she took the letter out and she gave it to him. He took it to our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he saw it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He called for Hatib. Sahaba were there. Umar was there. He saw it and he called him. He asked him, look how wise our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. He says, why did you do that, O Hatib? He wanted to listen. That's what a judge should do. Listen to two sides, not to one side only. Hatib spoke. He said, O the Messenger of Allah, I did not do this because I intended to betray you. The meaning of his statement. I did not do this because my iman is mixed with hypocrisy. I am a believer and I obey you and I follow you. But I did that because I had a hand within the Meccan community. I had some ties within the Meccan community and I wanted to keep that. I wanted to keep that relationship with some Meccans there. He confessed and he spoke the truth. What did Rasulullah say? He says to the Sahaba, I believe him. What did Umar say? Let me cut his head, O the Messenger of Allah. That's a betrayal, that's a treason. Death penalty for that. This is a well-known judgment. Even today, the punishment for treason in every country, perhaps, except the UK. The UK is a life sentence in prison, but every other country is death penalty for treason, betraying your own nation. Umar said that. Rasulullah said no. He's from the people of Badr. He's a man who fought with us in the battle of Badr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he might have forgiven all their sins. Leave him, and I believe him. Alhamdulillah. Hatib repented to Allah and Allah accepted his repentance. Shortly after that, what did the Prophet ﷺ do? The same man who committed that action, the Prophet ﷺ appointed him to be his ambassador. his messenger to where? To one of the mightiest kings on earth at that time, the king of Egypt, in the city called Iskandaria, by the sea. Can you imagine that the same man who committed that, the prophet is making him his messenger? This shows you how kind he was, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how understanding he was, how noble he was, how wise he was, how merciful he was. If it was another king or another leader or another ruler, they would have killed him without any hesitations, without thinking twice. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. O Muhammad, Allah sent you for no purpose but as a mercy to everything that exists, including your own enemies. You're a mercy to them. Subhanallah. But they did not appreciate that some of his enemies. That's why they were not worthy of the mercy the Prophet came with. And they are worthy of the punishment of Allah, because they refused to obey him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he appointed him. Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a, proudly, he took the message and the duty Allah Rasulullah sallam gave him. And he headed towards Egypt with a letter from Rasulullah sallam. He wrote a letter for the Persian emperor, Roman emperor, Egyptian emperor, Abyssinian emperor, saying, Bismillah min Muhammad ibn Abdullah Rasulullah, with the name of Allah, the most merciful, the very merciful, from Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, the son of Abdullah. And he wrote what he wrote, inviting them to Islam. When this king, by the name of Al-Muqawqis, received the letter from Hatib, he read the letter, and he replied to Hatib. He said to him, I am very much aware, because he was a Christian, I am very much aware that the Bible informs us and predicted that there'll come a prophet at this time. His description matches the description of the man you are describing to me, i.e. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But I was not expecting him to come from Mecca or Medina. I was expecting him to come from Sham, from Syria, Palestine, or Jordan, or Syria. I was expecting him to come out from there. What did he do? He wrote a letter back to our Rasul, technically acknowledging his prophecy and confessing his failure to embrace the message of our Rasul. And he spoke very politely in this letter. And he said to him, I have sent you some gift. He sent you lots of gold and silver. He sent you a special animal to ride. It was a very precious and expensive animal at that time. And he also sent him two women. Two what? Women. One of these women happened to be who? Mariah al-Qibtiyah, who had a very special status within the Egyptian community. He said to him, I'm sending you two women which are very special in our community. Her sister, Serene, she was the second woman. Mariah and her sister Serene. They were Christians at that time. Mariah al-Qibtiyah and her sister Serene. They were what? They were Christians. Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a had to take the letter to our Rasul and the gifts. On his way to Medina, Mariah and her sister Serene, they were Christians. They don't know what Medina is. They don't know what Mecca is. All they know about the Arabian Peninsula is a desert, pagans in there, and so on and so forth. They don't know that the best man has emerged, came out from Mecca to Medina, and he's enlightening humanity with the nur Allah gave him. So they were expressing some kind of panic. Hatib was a very wise man, very smart Sahabi. That's why the Prophet appointed him for this duty. Not anyone can be an ambassador or a messenger from the Messenger of Allah. You've got to choose the best one. What did he do? He saw them in that state. He started, according to some interpretations, he started telling them the story of Ibrahim, his wife Sarah, and who? Ibrahim had a quite similar story with his wife Sarah when they went to Egypt. What did the Egyptian king do? He took Sarah. And then when he knew he had no power over her, he let her go free. He couldn't harm her in any way, because she kept supplicating to Allah. And he gave her what a gift. Who was she? It was Hajar, later to be who? A mother of one of the best prophets, Ismail alayhi salam. So he told them this story, and the concept of Islam, and the concept of Tawheed, and the beauty of our Rasul who is waiting for them in Medina. It is said in that narration that before they reached Medina, they have already embraced Islam. Who are they? Sirin and her sister Maria, Qibtiyya. Alhamdulillah. And it is said in some narrations, they didn't accept Islam on their journey, but they accepted Islam the moment they saw our Rasul. The moment he spoke to them, they embraced Islam after he invited them. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw Maria al-Qibtiyya, he felt attracted to her. She was very attractive, very beautiful woman, and at the same time, very wise and smart. So he chose her for himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And her sister Sirin, he gave her to a sahabi called Hassan ibn Thabit. He gave her to him, and she became his woman. Rasulullah ﷺ had his beautiful relationship with his woman, bond woman, Maria al-Qibtiyya. But it doesn't stop that. The Prophet had some wives that he had Aisha, he had Hafsa, he had Zainab, he had at least 11 wives. Khadija wasn't there, had passed away, but at least 9 or 10 wives. Now, Aisha says in a sound hadith that I was never jealous of any women of the Prophet Muhammad like I was with Maria al-Qibtiyya. And she says, that's the literal statement of Aisha, she was very beautiful and attractive. Of course, all the wives of our Rasul are beautiful and attractive and wise and smart and pious and righteous. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his creation and made them different in different qualities and different looks and different shapes. Subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalla. Why? Because Maria al-Qibtiyya, most of the wives of our Rasul were Arabs. And were from the Arabian Peninsula. Okay? They spoke the same language, very much same culture. But Maria al-Qibtiyya came from a different religion, Christianity. Came from a different race of humanity, Egypt. They were different to the Arabs, spoke not the same language, no same religion, no same culture. So it was something different. So the jealousy can increase in here. And it's natural. The Prophet was having his relationship with his woman, Maria al-Qibtiyya, and he gave her a house somewhere, a little bit far from the hujurat of our Rasul, the rooms of the wives of our Rasul, which was surrounding the masjid, his masjid al-Nabawi, radiyallahu anhunna ajma'in. Once, Hafsa radiyallahu anha wa ardaha, he had a turn. Her night, or her day with our Rasul was to be that time. Rasul came to the house of Hafsa, and Hafsa left to do something in the house of her father, Umar al-Khattab. Maria al-Qibtiyya happened to be passing by. Rasulullah saw her, and he invited her into the house of who? Of Hafsa, his wife. And she went there, and he had a relationship with her in the house of Hafsa, in the room of Hafsa, in the bed of Hafsa. Hafsa surprisingly came and she found the Prophet with his woman in her bed. She was really unhappy with that. And she started complaining to the Prophet, what is going on? Jealousy of women is very natural to react like that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to some interpretations, he wanted to please Hafsa, telling her, calm down, this will not happen again. And according to some interpretations, what did he do? He swore by Allah that this will not happen again and he will not approach Maria al-Qibtiyya anymore. Because she was a bound woman and Hafsa was a wife. There's a slight difference in here. Maybe you explain this next time, inshallah ta'ala, if we have time. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Al-Tahrim because of that incident according to some interpretations of some ulama. He says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ لِمَا تُحَرِّمُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكْ تَبْتَغِي مَرْضَاتَ أَزْوَاجِكَ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. O Prophet, why would you forbid that which Allah made permissible for you in order to seek the pleasure of your wives? But indeed Allah has forgiven you, since He is the all-forgiving, the all-merciful. Some ulama, they say this ayah was revealed after this incident. And some, they say it was a slight different incident with the Hani and Zainab and so on and so forth. Different opinions. Now, Allah is teaching Muhammad that Maria al-Qibtiyah is halal for you. Bond woman is halal for you. So why would you take an oath in order to please one of your wives, Hafsa? And making something halal for you forbidden. Don't do that. Allah is addressing Muhammad in here, but the order goes to his followers too. A lesson to learn. Never make something halal haram. The Prophet never intended that. He never intended to make something haram, halal haram, but it was a natural reaction to please his wife, to calm her down. قَدْ فَرَضَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ تَحِلَّةَ أَيْمَانِكُمْ وَاللَّهُ مَوْلَاكُمْ. And then Allah taught Muhammad the solution, how to expiate his oath. How to expiate his oath. Expiation. By feeding 10 people, or dressing them, or freeing a slave, or fasting 3 days for the sake of Allah, as an expiation for your oath that you didn't fulfill. Alhamdulillah. And then Allah told us a story. وَإِذْ أَسَرَّ النَّبِيُّ إِلَىٰ بَعْضِ أَزْوَاجِهِ حَدِيثًا فَلَمَّا نَبَّأَتْ بِهِ وَأَظْهَرَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ عَرَّفَ بَعْضَهُ وَأَعْرَضَ عَنْ بَعْضٍ. لَمَّا نَبَّأَهَا بِهِ قَالَتْ مَنْ أَنْبَأَكَ هَذَا؟ قَالَ نَبَّأَنِيَ الْعَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. إِنْ تَتُوبَا إِلَى اللَّهِ فَقَدْ سَغَتْ قُلُوبُكُمَا وَإِنْ تَظَاهَرَا عَلَيْهِ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ مَوْلَاهُ وَجِبْرِيلُ وَصَالِحُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ ظَهِيرٌ. The time does not allow us, but I'll explain this ayat briefly. Recall, remember when the Prophet told a secret to one of his wives. Who's his wife in here? Hafsa. And what did Hafsa do? She did not keep this as a secret. She told Aisha what happened. She told Aisha, and that's the nature of women when it comes to jealousy. And they had every right to be jealous, walillahi alhamd. Because there is jealousy that is good and there is jealousy that is not good. Allah can be jealous if His boundaries are crossed. But the jealousy of Allah is not like the jealousy of us. Good people can be jealous. There is healthy jealousy and there is bad jealousy. And that's the healthy jealousy which the wives of our Rasul were experiencing, walillahi alhamd. So Aisha and Hafsa, they had that conversation. And when the Prophet heard that, he told them what was going on. He didn't tell them everything, he told them some and he left some. Hafsa asked him, who informed you that I have spoken to someone else? He said, نَبَّأَنِي الْعَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the all-knowing. Al-Khabir, he is the one who told me. إِن تَتُوبَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. يعني حفصة وعائشة. If you repent to Allah, or Hafsa and Aisha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your repentance after سَغَتْ قُلُوبُكُمَا. Your hearts were a little bit deviated from the truth in that particular matter, in that particular matter of jealousy and Maryam Qibtiyah. But if you support one another against our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you keep arguing against our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then know well that Allah and His messengers and the righteous believers are the awliya of our Rasul, are the friends, the supporters of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It means if you don't repent to Allah, then you will be wrongdoers. And of course, Hafsa and Aisha and the rest of the wives of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiyallahu anhunna ajma'een, lastunna ka ahadin minan nisa. They're not like the rest of women. They're special women. Allah says, wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum. The wives of the prophets are the mothers of the believers. This is enough honor from Allah to the wives of our Rasul, all of them. 13 women. 11 wives and 2 bound women. Walillahi alhamd. Now, Maria al-Qibtiyah became pregnant. She became what? Pregnant. She gave birth to a son called Ibrahim, the son of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He didn't have a son or a child for how long? For long years, at least 16 or 17 years. The last son he had, who was he? We mentioned this earlier this morning. The last son he had, and he died at a very young age. His name was what? Was Abdullah. He was known for 2 nicknames. What are they? Let's remember those who were here. Do you remember the nicknames of Abdullah, the son of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was born at the start of his prophecy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam?
Tahir and Waqi'a.
Is he right? Yes, he is. Alhamdulillah. At-tayyib and at-tahir. And the oldest son or the oldest child of our Rasul, who was he? The first one was born to our Rasul, yes. Al-Qasim. Al-Qasim. So after Abdullah, he didn't have any children, all the way to the 8th year. All the way to the 8th year when Maria al-Qibtiyya gave birth to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Rasulullah s.a.w., the night Ibrahim was born, he was very joyful, s.a.w. He was very happy. He was telling the Sahaba, Al-layla wulida li, ibnun sammaytuhu Ibrahim. I named him like his father Ibrahim, in the exact words of the hadith. Tonight Allah blessed me with a son, I named him after his father Ibrahim. He was very happy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he did aqiqah for his son, Ibrahim alayhi salam. And he gave him to a wet nurse, a woman which he hired to suckle his baby for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it was the custom of the Arabs at that time. However, Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he reached the age of 16 months or 18, could not live anymore. He felt extremely sick. And his wet nurse invited our Rasul to do something about it. When Rasul went with Anas ibn Malik to see his son Ibrahim, he picked him up and his son was having fever and he was very sick. And he started dropping tears, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Bukhari. And he couldn't do anything. He knew his son was dying. His only son at that time. But he said his famous statement in Sahih Bukhari, narrated by Anas ibn Malik, he says, إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَدْمَعَ وَإِنَّ الْقَلْبَ لَيَحْزَنُ وَإِنَّ عَلَى فِرَقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ لَمَحْزُونُونَ وَلَا نَقُولُ إِلَّا مَا يُرْضِي رَبُّنَا عَزَّ وَجَلُ بِمَعْنَ إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. He says, indeed, eyes drop tears and the heart grieves. And indeed, Ibrahim, for your separation, for your death, we are grieving. We're experiencing sadness in here. It's natural to grieve for someone that you love when they pass away. But not to take that beyond the boundaries Allah set for us. And we cannot say but that which pleases Allah, which means to Allah we belong and to Allah we return. He died. Alayhi salam, and Rasulullah asked Ali ibn Abi Talib to bury him. And they buried him, and they prayed his janazah. The same day Ibrahim alayhi salam passed away, what happened? The solar eclipse, kusuf, kasafat shams. Some people in Medina were saying the eclipse happened because of the death of Ibrahim. When the Prophet heard this, he gave a speech and he says, إن الشمس والقمر لا ينكسفان ولا يخسف. إن الشمس, the sun does not do any خسوف, and the moon does not do any خسوف. The sun is الكسوف and the moon is خسوف. Okay, the solar or the lunar eclipse do not happen لموت أحدنا وحياة أحد ولكنهما آيتان من آيات الله عز وجل. They are nothing but two signs, two miracles from Allah. If you see them, hasten to the masjid praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he taught them a lesson that this eclipse, solar eclipse, did not happen for the death of my own son, but it happened because Allah wanted something. Allah wanted to show you one of his signs, subhanahu wa ta'ala, jalla jalaluh. And he taught them the sunnah that needs to be done when there is the solar or the lunar eclipse, to pray the special salah he taught us, and to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save you from that and to protect you. Anas ibn Malik was asked in Musnad Imam Ahmad, or he said in Musnad Imam Ahmad, had Ibrahim, the son of our Rasul, lived, he would have been a Nabi after his father. If Ibrahim survived and lived after his father, he would have been a prophet. But Allah wished that there'll be no prophet after Muhammad at all. Khatam al-Nabiyyin. He's the seal of all prophets. He's the seal of all prophets. This is the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the son of our Rasul salam, with his mother Maria al-Qibtiyya. And Maria al-Qibtiyya passed away. She lived after our Rasul salam, and she died in the time of Umar bin Khattab. When she passed away, Umar radiallahu anhu al-Radah arranged for her funeral, and lots of Sahaba, lots of Muslims prayed her janazah. رضي الله عنها وعليها السلام ورضي الله عن أزواج النبي أجمعين آمين يا رب العالمين وصلي اللهم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We have some questions.